Fourth, starting methods. For this, we need to discuss about what is a synchronous motor. So, synchronous motor is a synchronous machine which converts AC electrical energy input to mechanical energy output with the help of DC excitation. But this is not valid because synchronous motor is not a self-starting motor. So if it is not a self-starting motor, how much energy input you give, there will be no output power developed from synchronous motor. So to make this valid, there must be some special arrangement that we'll be discussing now. So first, give AC electrical energy input to synchronous motor, and then with special arrangement make the rotor to achieve or run at synchronous speed. And as soon as rotor achieves synchronous speed, switch on DC excitation. So as soon as the rotor achieves synchronous speed by the special arrangement, then we need to give DC excitation. So once the DC excitation is given, then there will be magnetic locking between stator poles and rotor poles, and that makes the synchronous motor to rotate at synchronous speed. So this is how we can get mechanical energy output from a synchronous motor. And depending on the way by which the rotor of synchronous motor is made to achieve synchronous speed, there are three starting methods. First method is auxiliary motor starting method, and second, induction or damper winding starting method, and third, synchronous induction starting method. Of these three methods, first two methods will be discussed, and about third method, a simple statement is enough. Now let's have our discussion on first method, that is auxiliary motor starting method. So here the auxiliary motor can be a DC shunt motor or induction motor or pony motor, and in this method there will be a special discussion on pony motor. And to use these motors in this method, certain conditions are to be satisfied by these motors, that is, they must be self-starting and they must be speed controlled and they must be able to attain more than synchronous speed. So if these conditions are satisfied by these motors can be used in this method. So now let's discuss about this method with DC shunt motor. For that, let this be the supply lines to which our salient pole type synchronous motor is connected, and let this be the field winding, and let this be the external resistance, and let this be the switch, and this be the DC excitation supply. So we discussed that to get output from a synchronous motor, first we need to give AC electrical energy input, and with some special arrangement we need to bring the rotor speed to synchronous speed. And once the rotor achieves synchronous speed, then we need to give the DC excitation supply. So here the special arrangement is by using a DC shunt motor, we are bringing the rotor speed to synchronous speed. So now let's see the sequence of steps to be followed to start this method. So first step, short circuit rotor winding with a resistor of resistance 5 to 6 times the rotor field winding resistance. So why there is a necessity to short circuit the field winding resistance with the resistor? Means if suppose before giving DC excitation supply, let there be some residual EMF present in the field winding. So without noticing that, if we give the DC excitation supply, that DC excitation supply and the residual EMF might get aided. So if they get aided, there might be chance of rotor insulation failure. So it's why to avoid the rotor insulation failure, first we need to make the residual EMF zero before applying DC excitation. So reduce that residual EMF present in the field winding to zero. We are short circuiting the field winding resistance with a resistor. And why this resistor must have 5 to 6 times more than the resistance of field winding circuit means, if the resistance of this resistor is more, then the residual EMF which is present in the field winding will reduce to zero at faster rate. So is why this resistor value must be more than the field winding resistance. And there is one more advantage of short circuiting the field winding resistance. That is, if suppose there is residual EMF present in the field winding before applying DC excitation, then to reduce the EMF to zero, we are short circuiting with a resistor. Means once this circuit is short circuited, then current will flow, and once there is current, there will be torque produced, and that torque will help the rotor to achieve synchronous motor at faster rate. So short circuiting the field winding will provide additional starting torque to the rotor to attain synchronous speed at faster rate. Now the second step, give input supply to the synchronous motor. And third step, give input supply to DC shunt motor and adjust its speed to synchronous speed. So as DC shunt motor is coupled to synchronous motor, so rotor of synchronous motor also rotates at synchronous speed. So the fourth step is, once the rotor achieves synchronous speed by the special arrangement, that is by DC shunt motor, give the DC excitation supply by closing the switch. But remember that once the DC excitation supply is given, the supply to the auxiliary motor must be disconnected. So if it is not disconnected at the instant the DC excitation is given, it might result in unstable operation. So the instant DC excitation supply is given, we need to disconnect the supply to the auxiliary motor. So in the fourth step, at the same instant, supply to auxiliary motor is disconnected. So, once the DC excitation supply is given, there will be magnetic locking present between stator poles and rotor poles. So, once they get magnetically locked, the rotor of synchronous motor will continue to rotate at synchronous speed, because stator poles will rotate at synchronous speed. So, there is no necessity of keeping on the auxiliary motor once the magnetic locking happened. Let us suppose that we didn't disconnect the supply to the auxiliary motor, and because of magnetic locking, let the synchronous motor is rotating at synchronous speed. Now, if there is any input change to the auxiliary motor, that will reflect in the output of auxiliary motor. Means, speed of auxiliary motor will vary. And due to the change in input, this shaft will try to deviate from the synchronous speed, because there is change in input. So, is why it will result in unstable operation. In some cases, if the change is more, it might break the magnetic locking between stator poles and rotor poles. So, is why the instant DC excitation supply is given, we need to disconnect the supply to the auxiliary motor to get stable operation. So, the difficulty which is present here, that is, at the same instant we need to give DC excitation and remove the supply to the auxiliary motor. And this difficulty can be overcome by using pulling motor. Now, let us see how it is overcome. So, now, let's see the sequence of steps to be followed to start a synchronous motor by auxiliary starting method with auxiliary motor as pulling motor. So, let this be the salient pole type synchronous motor, and let this be the field winding, and let this be the resistance, and this be the switch, and this be the DC excitation supply. So, here the special arrangement is by providing a pony motor. That is, with the help of pony motor, we are making the rotor to achieve synchronous speed. And pony motor is defined as the induction motor which is having two poles less than the synchronous motor which we are going to start. Pony motor is simply induction motor which is having two poles less than the synchronous motor. And why the pony motor must have two poles less than the synchronous motor will be discussed now. Let's see the sequence of steps to be followed to start the synchronous motor by using auxiliary motor starting method. So, the steps are short circuit the field winding, circuit with a resistor of resistance phi 2, 6 times the rotor winding resistance. Remember here that short circuiting field winding serves two purposes. One, it reduces the residual EMF to zero, and the other purpose is it provides additional starting torque for the rotor to achieve synchronous speed at faster rate. And the second step, give input supply to synchronous motor. And third step, give input supply to pony motor, and wait until it achieves more than synchronous speed, that is close to synchronous speed. And then fourth step, disconnect the supply to pony motor. So once the supply to the pony motor is disconnected, pony motor speed will drop from maximum speed to synchronous speed and then to zero. The fifth step is, upon dropping the speed of pony motor to synchronous speed, give DC excitation. So, once the DC excitation is given, when the rotor is at synchronous speed, then there will be magnetic locking present between stator poles and rotor poles, so that rotor will continue to rotate at synchronous speed. So, the sixth step is due to magnetic locking, synchronous motor will rotate at synchronous speed. So if you observe here, we disconnected the supply to the auxiliary motor before giving DC excitation. Whereas in previous case, the instant DC excitation supply is given, we need to disconnect the supply to the auxiliary motor. So if we didn't disconnect the supply to the auxiliary motor, there will be unstable operation if there is change in input supply to the auxiliary motor. And here there is no such case, because after giving DC excitation, there is no supply to the auxiliary motor. And we given DC excitation supply at the instant, the rotor dropped its speed to synchronous speed. So rotor is at synchronous speed and we given DC excitation. So at that instant, there will be magnetic locking and the rotor will continue to rotate at synchronous speed. So this is how we can obtain stable operation by using pony motor. So in case of synchronous motor, we given DC excitation when the pony motor drops from maximum speed to synchronous speed. But few of you might think that why can't we give DC excitation supply when the pony motor raises its speed from minimum speed to synchronous speed before it achieves maximum speed. If you observe here, in this case of the pony motor raising from initial speed to maximum speed, at this instant, the instant DC acceleration supply is given, here there is supply to the pony motor, so which might result in unstable operation. Whereas in this case, that is when the pony motor drops from maximum speed to synchronous speed, there is no supply to the auxiliary motor in this case. So giving DC excitation in this case will result in stable operation. Let's have a short discussion on how the EMF present in the field winding before giving DC excitation supply. For that, when the input supply is given to the synchronous motor, because of the interaction between the fluxes in each phases, there will be rotating magnetic field created in the air gap present between stator and rotor. And that rotating magnetic field will rotate at synchronous speed. And as the rotor is stationary, so there will be a relative motion present between the stator rotating magnetic field and stationary rotor. And because of that relative speed, there will be an EMF induced in the field winding. And that induced EMF is of AC nature. And we are increasing the speed of rotor with the help of auxiliary motor. So as the speed of rotor increases to achieve synchronous speed, the relative speed between the stator rotating magnetic field and rotor will decrease. So as the relative speed between rotating magnetic field and rotor is decreasing, EMF will be also decreased. So the instant rotor achieves the synchronous speed, there will be no relative motion between the stator rotating magnetic field and rotor. So EMF induced will be also zero. So during the process of starting, whatever the EMF induced, okay, that is reduced by short circuiting the field winding with a resistor. And we discussed one more advantage, that is, as it is short circuited, there will be current flow, so it will get stuck, and which helps the rotor to achieve synchronous speed at faster rate. Now let's get into our second method, induction or damper winding starting method. So let this be the input supply to which our synchronous motor is connected. Let us consider 4 pole salient pole type synchronous motor, and let this be the slots in the pole shoes of salient pole rotor in which our damper bars are placed and the end connections are short circuited with the copper ring on both sides. So this is the damper winding. And let this be the field circuit which is short circuited with the resistance, and let this be the switch, and this be the DC excitation supply. And here the special arrangement is damper winding. So now let's discuss the sequence of steps to be followed to start the synchronous motor by this method. So first step, short circuit the field winding with resistor of resistance phi 2 6 times the field winding resistance. And second, give the input supply to synchronous motor. As here there are damper windings, there will be induction motor action takes place in the synchronous motor because of damper winding. So because of the induction motor action, the rotor will achieve the speed close to the synchronous speed. So the third step is wait until the rotor achieves the speed close to synchronous speed. And then the fourth step. So once the rotor achieves the speed close to the synchronous speed, due to magnetic pull by the stator poles, rotor poles are aligned with stator poles. That is, magnetic locking happens. So the fourth step is, due to magnetic pull, there is magnetic locking between stator poles and rotor poles. So once there is magnetic locking, the rotor will continue to rotate at synchronous speed. So by this method, we completely eliminated the difficulty which we discussed in first method. And also here there is no necessity of additional motor 2. But remember one point about this method is that during starting, the synchronous motor will behave as squirrel cage induction motor. And now the third method, synchronous induction starting method. So if you know about first two methods, that is auxiliary motor starting method and induction or damper winding starting method, there is nothing much to know about synchronous induction starting method. Because here the only thing you must keep in mind that during starting, the synchronous motor will run as slip ring induction motor, which means here we can include the extra resistance to increase the starting torque during starting. So by including extra resistance, if starting torque increases, which implies the motor achieves synchronous speed at faster rate. And next topic, power equations. In case of synchronous motor, we will come across both input power equations and output power equations. Whereas in case of alternator, what are the power equations that are derived? All those represent output power equations. So please keep that in mind. First, let's see about vector diagram of synchronous motor. And it is discussed that delta, which is load angle, is negative for synchronous motor. And if suppose this is the terminal voltage V, to terminal voltage V, E lags behind V by angle delta. So let us suppose this is the armature current IA. And the motor voltage equation is input voltage V is equal to EB plus J IA ZS, where ZS is synchronous impedance, which can be represented like this, RA plus J XS. So to obtain V, we have to add IA ZS to EB. So this is E. To get V, we need to add IA ZS. And IAZS can be represented like this, that is IARA plus JIXS. So if this is the IARA drop, and next we have to represent IAXS drop, which will be perpendicular to IA phasor. So drawing at perpendicular, this is IA axis, and this is the resultant, that is we got V. And the relation between internal power factor angle and power factor angle and load angle is psi is equal to 5 plus or minus delta, where plus is for leading and minus for lagging. And here psi represents internal power factor angle, that is angle between E and IA. So this is psi. And phi represents power factor angle, which is angle between V and IA. So this is phi. And you know delta is load angle, which is the angle between main field MMF and air gap MMF. And by neglecting armature resistance drop and leakage reactance drop, load angle can be considered as the angle between V and E. So between E and V, we represented it with delta. Whereas in case of alternator, psi is equal to 5 plus or minus delta, but plus for lagging and minus for leading in case of alternator. And now let's derive the power flow equations of synchronous motor. So if this be the input voltage V, which is taken as a reference, and let this be the synchronous impedance, which is equal to R plus J XS, and let this be the back EMF EP, and which is taken at an angle minus delta. So the input current be IA, which implies IA is equal to V at an angle 0 minus EB at an angle minus delta by ZS at an angle theta, where theta is equal to tan inverse of XS by RA, which is called impedance angle. So complex power input is equal to P plus JQ, that is equal to V into IA star, where V is input voltage and I is armature current IA. So here we took IA star, which is complex conjugate of armature current IA. So therefore IA star is equal to V at an angle minus 0 degrees means 0 minus EB at an angle minus delta means here plus delta by ZS at an angle theta means here minus theta, because complex conjugate, that is equal to V by ZS at an angle theta minus EB by ZS at an angle delta plus theta. So place complex conjugate of armature current in complex power equation, that implies S is equal to V at an angle 0 into V by ZS at an angle theta minus EB by ZS at an angle delta plus theta. So upon solving, the real term represents the real power input and imaginary term represents the reactive power input. So that implies real power input, so P is equal to V square by ZS into cos theta minus EB V by ZS into cos theta plus delta. And complex power input, Q is equal to V square by ZS into sin theta minus EB by ZS into sin theta plus delta. So these are the input power equations for a synchronous motor. And if you compare these input power equations of synchronous motor with output power equations of alternator, there are minute differences, so it is very easier to remember these equations, but keep those differences in mind. And now the condition for maximum input power. For that, we need to differentiate P with respect to load angle and equate to zero. So when the real power is differentiated with respect to load angle delta, then we get the condition delta is equal to 180 degrees minus theta. And if you place this in this, implies P input max is equal to V square by ZS into cos theta plus EV by ZS. This is the equation for maximum input power. And now let's derive the output power equations of synchronous motor in terms of electrical quantities. Therefore, mechanical power developed is equal to active component of EV into IS star. So place the equation of IA and EB, that is EB at an angle minus delta and IS star, then the mechanical power developed is equal to active component of EB into IS star. That implies Pmax is equal to EV by ZS into cos theta minus delta minus E square by ZS into cos theta. So this is the output power equation of synchronous motor. Please keep in mind that in case of synchronous motor, if you are representing EMF, it is the back EMF. And if you compare this output power equation with alternator output power equation, the only change present here is E. Whereas in case of alternator, here in place of E square, there will be V square and here E square. So this is the only minor difference between the output power equations of alternator and synchronous motor. And if we neglect armature resistance, that implies impedance angle will be 90 degrees and that implies output power equation is equal to EV by axis into sine delta. Whereas for input power equation, which we got, that is V square by ZS into cos theta minus EV by ZS into cos theta plus delta. And upon neglecting armature resistance, that implies input power equation is equal to EV by axis sine delta. So if you observe here, by neglecting RA, input power equation and output equations are same. And now let's discuss about the condition for maximum output power. That is differentiating Pmax with respect to load angle and equating to zero, we get delta is equal to theta. So the condition for maximum output power is delta is equal to theta, and the same we get in case of alternator. So if you place this condition in this equation, we get maximum output power equation is equal to EV by ZS minus E square by ZS into cos theta. So this is the maximum output power equation. The same equation we will get in case of alternator, but in place of E square, there V square will be there. So till now, what are the power equations we derived for synchronous motor? It represents the cylindrical pole type synchronous motor. And whereas for salient pole type, the output power equation is same as that of salient pole type alternator output power equation. That is, P is equal to EV by XV into sine delta plus V square by 2 into 1 by XQ minus 1 by XT into sine 2 delta. In this, the first term represents the electromagnetic power, whereas the second term represents the reluctance power. So if you compare this output power equation with the cylindrical pole type synchronous motor output power equation, this power equation has extra term, which implies output power developed in case of synchronous motor is more when compared with the cylindrical pole type synchronous motor. So is why salient pole type of synchronous motors are said to be more stable when compared with cylindrical pole type synchronous motors.